Hello and welcome back to the Grandmaster Division of the Intermezzo Championship. In my first game I was able to win against Aaron Green and Footloop, and now in my second game I will play against Footloop and Demiris. So I started with a win, Footloop with a loss. Demiris, who finished third in the last season, has no game finished yet, and yeah, and so we can also immediately start taking a look at the game. First of all, we can take a look at the Leaders and Wonders. We can see that there is some culture strategy available. We have Chaplin, Fleming, and the Hollywood in H3, and then in H2 we have Bach, Gaudi, Darwin. So that's definitely something. Definitely also a little bit of science energy. There could be Nobel Prizes. We have Gates, we have Sid Meier, Einstein, but we have no space flight, at least the Manhattan Project. There is also the International Red Cross. And we also have Gandhi and Churchill for the military. In H2 we have the Suez Canal and James Cook, so a colonization strategy could work out. You have the Ocean Liner Service, New Maria, also Harvard College statue as some nice economy wonder. So statue, of course, also has got some culture. And then we have James Watt to maybe catch up in the economy if you don't go for iron early in the game. We have Machu Picchu, Universitas, the Great Wall but no Magic Castle in H1, the Silk Road is also available, neither Forbidden City nor St. Peter's Basilica are there. We have both military action leaders in H1, Jan Szyszkanczyn of Arc, also Genghis Khan and Barbarossa, some strength leaders, Barbarossa, Eleanor and Columbus all work nicely with the Suez Canal, and then we have also Leonardo for some alchemy and printing press synergy. Now, I'm in first position and I think I want to pick the Colosseum here. Because I ideally want to take a leader or wonder. If I take Homer, then Colosseum and Library might be taken. Then Rome Roads will very likely stay on two civil actions. So either I pay an additional civil action for that, and I already don't like it too much together with Homer, because it's just so civil action heavy, and then taking it for an additional civil action even, I think it's just too costly. Homer with Hanging Gardens is also not ideal. And if I take the Colosseum now, then maybe Homer is still available, even though I think I don't like Homer too much with the Colosseum. So I would maybe prefer to get one of those leaders, and it's very likely that Ashoka at least will be available for one civil action. But it's also definitely possible, if Homer, Richland and Library will get taken, that Boudica will be available for one civil action as well. And without Caesar, Sansu and Alex in the game, I think Boudica could work out quite nicely, and so I think I would prefer her over Ashoka, because Ashoka I like more when maybe playing in second or third position. Yeah, so I went for the Colosseum here, already the second game of the season where I go for the Colosseum, even though I don't like it too much in three-player games, but maybe those games will convince me, who knows. Then Footloop goes for the Library, and Demiris just goes for Mare, gets the leader, and can take Elm Growth and Richland, gets two resources, so basically like an engineering genius, and that's definitely not bad for him. And with that, also Ashoka and Boudica available for one civil action for me, but I will actually go for Hammurabi here. I thought about if I maybe just want to go for Boudica. I actually like her quite a lot, especially in four-player games, but now that there is no strength leader, I think she could also do some nice work now in a three-player game. But Hammurabi is just, it's just very strong, works nicely together with the Colosseum. If I take Boudica, then Hammurabi would be available for one civil action for Footloop, and then he could actually do a very nice turn, because I won't take this Engineering Genius for two, and then he could do a very nice turn with going for Hammurabi and using the one additional civil action from Hammurabi to pick up the Engineering Genius. I think that would be a very strong start for him, and Hammurabi I think will also work out nicely for myself, hopefully. So I was willing to pay an additional civil action for him, and I went for my mine, increased my population. No, I don't want to pick the Engineering Genius here, I don't think it's really necessary, I don't have an economy wonder that I want to rush out, and it's just a little bit costly to spend two civil actions on it. Then Footloop goes for Boudica now. The start with Boudica is also very fine, because in the next turn he can take a resource with Boudica, and together with the Engineering Genius that will allow him to finish the library immediately at the next turn. Then it's Tamara's turn. He would have the option to go for the lab first, instead goes for the mine first. And there's also a very early Universitas, but instead he goes for the Rome Roads. I think I maybe would prefer the Universitas here. I mean, it's more costly, meaning that it's maybe a little bit more difficult to replace for Mayor, but yeah, getting an early Universitas, I think, is just very, very strong. And even though the Rome Roads are, of course, also not bad, I think I might prefer the Universitas here. But in Tamarisons, that goes for the Rome Roads, elect Sumer, and yeah, maybe wants to finish the Rome Roads as soon as possible. If he now the next turn builds the lab with the urban growth, then he has for certain 5 civil actions at a turn after that, and can then maybe finish Rome Roads and replace Homer relatively early. This turn was a little bit difficult for me, and I didn't really know exactly what I want to do. I can build this lab, and then I have a bunch of civil actions that I can spend with Hammurabi, but they are not really the most cards that I really want to take on the row. So I thought about maybe increasing population, taking frugality, and maybe another HA yellow card, but it felt kinda bad, and also taking frugality after already having increased population is also not too great. I even thought about taking the rich land, but before I take the rich land, it's probably better to just take frugality and maybe this rich land A, so that's only one resource left, but I also get the 2 additional food. And then the question was, should I already increase my food production and get into consumption? I could also, instead of building the lab, build 2 stages of the Colosseum just to take 1 more civil action, and to already use 1 more civil action on that. No. But at the end, I just went for the lab, and I went for the frugality and for Eleanor. So, no, that was sort of course an interesting pick, but I think it makes sense because I have Hammurabi. Hammurabi will just be a very fine leader for a while, especially with the Colosseum. I also in the later part of H1, where maybe I have to build some military, that hopefully will be possible with the Colosseum, even though I have Hammurabi. And yeah, and then Eleanor is just a very nice transition leader. I don't need her now immediately, but no, I mean, I have to pick a leader at some point. Now I already spent those civil actions, and and then I can just use her as a nice transition leader at the end of H1 and keep Hammurabi for now. And at the next turn, I can use the frugality to increase my population 2 times. I could build 2 stages of the Colosseum, so if it should be the case that at the next turn still they are not the most important cards on the row, then I have a bunch of stuff that I could do to just improve my civilization. Then I draw the Uncertain Borders here. Footloop takes the resource of Boudica and uses it to finish the library immediately, increases its population, gets 1 science production like this, still has a 3 population, still is not in consumption, so that's quite a nice start for him. Tamara recedes, and the development of markets is revealed, and that actually allows him to just finish the Rome Roads. That's also what he does. Like this, he could maybe already replace Homer the next turn if a leader is in the row. He gets the additional resource production of the Rome Roads immediately, and then the next turn he can then maybe start build a second lab. Or maybe even going for this alchemy directly. Yeah, this turn I can use the frugality to increase my population. I can increase my population 2 times, then I can get out of corruption with building 1 step, and I just took the knights. Having this military technology in hand I think is quite nice. And no. Also, to once again talk about Eleanor, I think with the Colosseum, that's also an argument for Eleanor. I will have 3 military actions, I will be able to keep some cards in hand that I draw from her. So, yeah, so that's also a little bit of a nice synergy. Yeah. And I take the knights. I don't have a tactic yet, but I think it's just really nice to have them in hand. Of course, I could also just take rich land or something, but I rather want to have the military technology in hand. And I actually draw a tactic now, the Heavy Cavalry, with the additional Happy Face of the Colosseum. It could definitely be possible that I will be able to go for 3 knights. So I was happy to have this option available, and with that maybe those strength events could also come in handy. Footloop also wants to have a military technology. It definitely might be the case that he has to use Boudica for 2 additional resources for military at some point, and then it would be nice if he can invest those resources into an upgraded military unit instead of just building more and more warriors. Tamaris seats again, and the development of religion is revealed. I have a 3 population now, Tamaris as well, Footloop as well, so we all can take the 3 religion. Demeris is missing one science to go for an alchemy directly, so he can't do this this turn. Instead, he goes for Barbarossa, replaces Homer, uses the resources of Homer to build one additional warrior, and then increases the population to get out of corruption. At the next turn, he has four science available, meaning that he can just build an alchemy directly, maybe even upgrade a second lab as well immediately. So that could then be a quite a nice boost to the science production. I actually played a call to arms here. As I said, I have noticed a recovery. I thought that I maybe have a shot at being the strongest with this tactic. It could also come a little bit too early, so I was not 100% convinced if it is the right thing to do. No, but I think there were also some developments that I was hoping for. Because this turn I have a little bit of an issue, and I think I had planned out a different turn actually, but because of the development of civil life, I think because of that I had to change stuff a little bit. I'm not sure if how much this changed, but I have one big issue, and I think that was also one reason why I wanted to push, because some additional science production could have been quite nice. At my next turn, I have six science available now, meaning that I could develop the Code of Laws. The problem is then I don't have enough science to go for knights at the next turn, and that would be kind of nice being able to do this. I can now also take the breakthrough, so I have basically the option to maybe go for knights already this turn, just having them developed, being able to build some, prepare to switch into their recovery. But then I don't have enough science to go for Code of Laws at the next turn. Or I go for Code of Laws this turn, but then I can't go for Knights at the next turn. Or as another option, I develop neither of those two technologies, and then with the breakthrough, I would be able to go for Code of Laws and Knights at the next turn. However, then I can't really use my last civil action very nicely, so I basically would just miss out on a civil action. And at the end, I made a decision to actually develop the Code of Laws. I already put one strength event in already, but it would maybe not be too bad if I should lose it. I have a bunch of civil actions now with Hammurabi. If I get Eleanor at some point, at least the additional cards could give me some more culture. I was willing to potentially delay the knights, but I get the additional civil action. I was eyeing the Silk Road that was coming down the row. I think that could be quite nice. I have the breakthrough in hand now with my last civil action. I will also take the frugality, which is not that great after I now already increased my population with the development of civil life, but hopefully I will still be able to make some use out of it, maybe even together with the Silk Road. And then I draw two raids. Footloop goes for the Great Wall, also develops Swordsman with the development of Civil Life, builds one Swordsman, and uses the resources of Booty Collect. This is the strongest, and also takes the drama. There is Bach in the game after all. Then Tamarus goes for Alchemy with the development of Civil Life, builds one, upgrades the other one, and then takes the Swordsman, the Patriotism. Like this here is also something to invest to maybe use the Barbarossa's activations for, can go now for Swordsman, and the Patriotism will also help with that. This turn, as I said, I was already eyeing the Silk Road at the last turn, and this turn I also made the decision to actually go for it. I could think about just grabbing Monarchy and doing a Hammurabi Revolution, but it's already a little bit late. I could then build a warrior to get out of corruption, and that's also not ideal with the heavy cavalry tactic that I maybe still want to go for at some point. And also I made the decision that I want to take this copy of Iron. At the moment I'm relatively low in science, but I might still be able to go for it at some point. It's also a little bit of a hate draft, because Footloop has the Great Wall, and I think it would be very nice for him if he can get some resource upgrades in before he finishes that. And so I wanted to deny this, like this, he can't easily upgrade anything at the next turn. And so I was willing to, or I wanted to take this Iron away. Then I have to spend my civil action somehow. I have a relatively full hand, that's why the Silk Road is quite handy. I can just use my civil action somehow. So I can build a first stage that gets me out of corruption. I can take the Iron, then my hand is full, I can't really do that much, and so I can just build two more stages of the Silk Road. That's nice. On the other hand, it also takes some resources, so going for 3 knight actually starts to become quite difficult. But I was eyeing this reserves coming down the row, and it could definitely be available for me at the next turn, and together with the Silk Road it could give me 3 additional resources, which hopefully could help me to get enough population for a knight for 3 knights at some point. Then I draw two events. At the next turn I probably will have to replace Hammurabi with Eleanor. Sadly, my opponents have an open borders agreement together. That's of course not great to see. Footloop finishes the Great Wall this turn. Legacy can use all of his resources, is now at 5 strength, and just has all of the civil actions out of the way. Otherwise, it maybe was difficult for him to get out of corruption. Yeah, and he actually skips on the Anshushka, skips on the knights. I mean, he has swordsmen already, so that's maybe fine. Instead, he can maybe go for Leonardo and Alchemy the next turn. Maybe he has a nice colony for Columbus, so there are definitely some other leaders that could do some nice work for him. Then Tamir recedes, and the development of Warfare is revealed, so that's quite nice. Tamir can't get a free warrior, the same is true for Footloop. I can take one, but just in one hand nice, in the other hand, then it makes it more difficult to switch into heavy cavalry, so I will have to see if I want to take this at my turn. Tamir goes for Swordsman, upgrades one, upgrades another one, and is also using Barbarossa, going up to 6 strength now, and then he is taking the growth and the irrigation. Irrigation, of course, being quite nice together with Barbarossa to get more activations out of him. At my turn, I develop the knights, scoring 3 signs with the breakthrough, making it possible that I maybe can go for iron at the next turn. I didn't have enough civil actions this turn. Then after this, I want to elect Eleanor. And I had to face, again, of course, like in every turn, I had to face a decision. And this decision was if I want to play it completely safe, or if I want to play it a little bit greedy, because the thing is, I have no defense card in hand, and Tamaris is at 6 strength, just went for a little bit of a strength push with Barbarossa. But I have 3 military actions, only 1 defense card would be enough, and I will draw 2 more cards. I already have drawn a bunch of cards. Tamaris has now 3 military actions thanks to the Open Borders Agreement, but it would still cost him draws to try to go for an aggression, and with that I was willing to not go for the knights, because then I can spend more civil actions nicely. If I go for the knights, maybe I can build 1 stage, but I think that's then actually also not that easy for me to get out of corruption with just building a knight. So I just there wasn't really a nice turn possible, or maybe somehow, but I think now the turn with the Silk Road is quite a bit better, and with that I was willing to take the risk that maybe Tamaris would go for an aggression against me. Finishing the Silk Road helps with corruption, gets me increases my science production, then I can take the reserves. As I said, this could definitely help me with my military, give me enough resources to build some units. It could also be nice together with the frugality, maybe to get some more population out, because sadly, very likely the age will end before my next turn, and it could be that I will be stuck at 3 food, not being able to use the frugality. And then with my last 2 actions, I thought that I either want to take Irrigation and Alchemy, and I think it's relatively clear that I should take Alchemy here. Like this, I just have one more thing that I could potentially upgrade to together with the Silk Road. If I go for 2 Alchemy upgrades, I'm at least at 5 Science Production, which is fine. And Footloop still needs a leader, and if I don't take the Alchemy, then Leonardo and Alchemy is available for him. So I wanted to remove this option from him, and with that took the Alchemy with my last 2 civil actions. I get the first 2 culture in with Eleanor, discard 2 cards, draw 2 new cards, no defense card, but another event, 2 strength events, and also the Dark Ages I have in hand, so for the strength events it definitely will depend on how easily I will get enough strength, and now that it will be difficult to get into heavy cavalry, at the end I took this free warrior just because it makes it look a lot more likely that I can defend against an aggression. And it is kind of difficult to get into 3 knights anyway, so and with that it might not be easy to go for a lot of strength, so I might maybe want to push the Dark Ages at the next turn. Footloop, now that Alchemy is removed, goes for Columbus. Maybe you want to do this anyway, especially if he has a strong tactic available. Can use 1 resource of Boudicca at least with this 1 upgrade, but then he has no free population, so the other resource will not be used. And with the last civil action, he will develop the irrigation. And, sadly, Tamaris indeed does go for an aggression, and I get punished for not preparing myself for military. I think I might still do the same, because the turn of the Silk Road was just a bit better, and it was quite likely that I could defend against an aggression. So maybe I shouldn't tell this in public, but I probably will do this again in a future turn in a situation like this, when I have the feeling that it's really an improvement over building a military unit. Yeah, but sadly, Tamuris goes for an aggression, he tries it, and he gets rewarded for it, steals three resources from me, and I was quite unhappy about it. Because, I mean, if you have a really strong economy and early age 1, if you have a lot of iron upgrades already, if you just were able to build up a bunch of upgrades already, then it's maybe not that bad to get hit by an aggression. But in this case, Tamurus might even have the better economy with having better science production, at least I have more civil actions, but no, I just didn't know if I really have any compensation for getting hit by this aggression, and so I was definitely unhappy about this. Tamurus goes for one more swordsman, is now even at 8 strength, and he also knows now that I have no H1 card in hand, and that's definitely a little bit dangerous for me now. So I was really hoping that maybe with the draw of Eleanor I would already draw an H2 defense card, that would help me quite a lot. But of course it's also not that likely. Then Tamuris goes for food upgrades that will allow him to do another activation of Barbarossa the next turn if he wants to, and also takes the cultural heritage. In my turn, as I said, I want to seed the Dark Ages into the deck. The development of planning is revealed, and the options for the development of planning are development of politics, agriculture and crafts. And I think there's actually a decision that I think very likely is the best one, and that is actually the development of politics. Of course, two additional resources or two additional food could be quite helpful. With the two additional food, I would be able to use the frugality. It would actually allow me to get two more population out, so that could be quite nice. The additional resources would help me to maybe go for more upgrades, or maybe be able to go for one upgrade and one knight together with the reserves. No, but I think there are a lot of arguments for taking the development of politics. First of all, as I said, Tamuris knows that I have no H1 defense card in hand. Even if I build a knight, I'm only at 4 strength, so I would still need an H2 defense card, because he knows that my H1 defense card aren't defense cards, so for the defense against Tamuris, it doesn't really make a big difference if I have 2 or 4 strength. I would, in both cases, still need an H2 defense card, and so I thought, with those three additional draws, it just makes it a lot more likely that I will get a defense card, and luckily I also did get one. But even if I now didn't get one, I think I would just stay at 2 strength and draw 3 more cards, and just hope that I will draw one, and if I don't draw one, then hopefully Tamuris, with having seen that I already have drawn 8 H2 cards, maybe that will then make him afraid of going for an aggression, and he maybe rather wants to maximize his own draws. So that's one argument. The next argument is of course just that it's Zeus H2 now, meaning that the draws are in general quite valuable. I could maybe draw a tactic or something like this. And then, as last argument, I have Eleanor. So getting those three additional draws just will also give me straight up three additional culture. And while culture is of course not that important in this stage of the game, it's still a nice bonus. So yeah. And it was an interesting decision to go for development of politics here, but I think it makes sense, and I was very happy that I drew this defense card, meaning that I, at the moment at least, don't necessarily have to increase my strength. It's still a little bit risky to not go for a knight, because if Footloop should go for an aggression, then maybe Tamuris could go against one, because I would not be able to defend against two aggressions. But Footloop also sees that I've drawn a lot of cards. He would miss out on card draws for himself. He maybe wants to go for a colony with Columbus anyway, so I was willing to take that risk. Then this turn, I want to start to go for some upgrades, and I just seeded the Dark Ages in, so I wanted to prepare for this, and because of the Dark Ages, it was relatively clear for me that I want to go for the Iron here, and not for the Alchemy. So I go for the Iron, I can play the reserves for 3 resources, thanks to the Silk Road, and then I can go for 1 upgrade, taking the Breakthrough and the Urban Growth. At the next turn, I will have 4 signs, so I don't lose anything to the Dark Ages, and if the Dark Ages aren't revealed before my next turn, then I can go for the Alchemy, develop it without the Breakthrough, and then go for some upgrades, one upgrade to alchemy, one upgrade to mines with the urban growth, meaning that I have still only 4 science, so like this I should be relatively nicely prepared for dark ages, and at least I can also maybe get up some production. Of course, when I will develop it without using the breakthrough, that maybe looks a little bit suspicious, but maybe not even that much, because at least it could be explained with just wanting to get some additional resources out of the Silk Road to get an additional bonus for the urban growth instead of the breakthrough. So it wouldn't be a completely clear sign of the Dark Ages. It could also just be that I want to get the Silk Road bonus for a different card. Yeah, so that was my plan for the next turn. And maybe I can get some resource production up. And also, if now, after getting the development of politics, I have a bunch of cards in hand, so I will actually get 6 additional culture out of Eleanor, so that's definitely quite nice. And I will also draw some more cards, and one colony, Cold War, and one aggression. Footloop Seeds and a Call to Arms is revealed, so sadly I will lose 2 civil actions, at least I get even more draws in, so Eleanor is happy again. And sadly no additional defense card, but a war and an aggression. And Footloop also takes the development of politics, and I think for him it also makes completely sense, because he has Columbus, he didn't use him yet, and with getting those additional draws, it's definitely more likely that he maybe can hit a jackpot and get a very early H2 colony together with him. He gets those draws, gets the additional draws immediately in after his turn, so I think also for him it makes a lot of sense to take the development of politics here. And in general, those are H2 cards, those are already valuable on their own, so even without additional reasons it could make sense to take the development of politics here, but for both me and Footloop there were even more additional reasons, and I think for both of us it makes completely sense to go for the development of politics. There's a territory revealed. I didn't really want to win it, because I thought I rather want to keep my defense card to defend against an aggression, but I also kind of wanted to show that I have a defense card. I have a bit 3, letting the others know I have one defense card, don't even try to go for an aggression against me. But I was hoping that I don't win the territory, and I also don't. And I also don't win it. Footloop wins it for 1 swordsman and 1 colonization card. And as you can see, Tamaris also went for the development of politics. I think he doesn't maybe really have a specific reason. Maybe he hopes to get an aggression, that he can maybe threaten us again. But as I said, in general, H2 draws that early are quite valuable. And if maybe the additional stuff would cause corruption anyway, now he's just getting barely out of corruption. So, but it's interesting. I don't know if I ever had this before, that the development of planning was revealed and all players took the development of politics out of it. Tamaris takes the call for 3 civil actions. This iron will be discarded, so Footloop is now a little bit dependent on when the second copy of coal will be available, because he probably wants to go for this at some point. So it may make sense that Tamaris takes this one away. He can start upgrading to coal at the next turn, and then he definitely has quite a decent economy. And with the big science production, he also maybe can get a government form in at some point. But with both of my opponents having some science saved up, Tamaris with the production, Footloop also with the developed territory now, I was really hoping that maybe now the Dark Ages might be revealed. And at my turn I see the arms industry, I draw an additional defense card, it could be helpful, also the international negotiations. Sadly, not the Dark Ages, the Crusades instead, so I will lose some of the culture that Eleanor has given me, and Tamaris will steal some of the culture, but at least it isn't anything that really disrupts me, so I think it's a fine outcome for me. The Dark Ages aren't revealed yet, so I go for the Alchemy without a breakthrough. I can go for one upgrade completely for free with the Urban Growth. I don't want to go for another upgrade to Alchemies, of course, because then I would just lose 1 science to the Dark Ages, so instead I just go for an upgrade to my mines, get out of corruption like this, upgrade my economy, and I don't really need any of those cards. I mean, Organized Religion would have been a nice pickup, so I maybe would have, if the Call to Arms wouldn't have been revealed, would have maybe taken Organized Religion, Rich Land, getting some more resources, having a Happy Face Solution. Definitely wouldn't have been bad to have the additional civil actions this turn, but I can still do something, and at least the additional cards make it that Eleanor again scores me 6 additional cultures, so she has given me for 2 turns in a row 6 culture. That's definitely not too shabby. This turn I also draw my first tactic, the Hussars. I mean, I have knights developed, so that's at least something, because at the moment no one has revealed any tactic, and having this as an option available is just quite nice. Footloop doesn't use Columbus yet, so that looks like he maybe hasn't drawn a nice colony yet, and he sees and the Dark Ages are revealed now, so I was quite happy to see this. That worked out quite nicely. I don't lose any signs, and both of my opponents lose a bunch of signs. Footloop increases his population, builds a swordsman, takes the breakthrough, and is willing to spend 3 civil actions on the conmon, but he hasn't enough signs now to go for it peacefully at the next turn, meaning that he maybe wants to do a revolution at the next turn. However, a revolution would mean that he would miss out on one of the cannons, which maybe is also something that he doesn't want to happen, because he has the Great Wall. Thamyris tries it again, goes for an aggression, but I had a lot of draws, and thankfully I have had 2 defense cards before the end of my turn, meaning that I could justify staying at 2 strength and getting some more economy upgrades, so all of those draws that I'm getting are kind of making me safe from an aggression. But now I've used 2 of my defense cards, so at my next turn I might be a little bit in trouble, or I maybe have to be, maybe I can somehow make it work that I can go for enough strength to defend myself. Thamyris goes for James Watt this turn. It's a relatively early James Watt, but he still of course gets a lot of value out of him with going for the coal mines, and Barbarossa maybe also wouldn't do it that much at the future turns. Thamyris doesn't take the cannon, so maybe Footloop predicted this, that maybe Thamyris will go for James Watt, wants to go for coal, and is willing to let the cannons go for that, so Footloop has still the chance maybe to go for the cannons at his next turn. This turn I didn't seed with Eleanor. I'm still the weakest, but of course that didn't stop me from seeding at the last turns, but this one additional resource that I get from the international trade agreement, that could just be very important, and because of that I wanted to get the pact going now, and I offered this pact to Thamyris. Because first of all, this turn I think I have to build this knight. First of all, it gets me out of corruption without having to spend a civil action, which will be important. Yeah, and sadly now I have used up my defense cards, and I don't really have any way how I can defend myself, but at least I wanted to make it look like, or I wanted it to be able to defend with at least 1 defense cards. Maybe that will make a difference if whether Thamyris tries an additional aggression or not, and at least I also have the chance that with those 2 draws that I get, that I maybe draw an additional defense card. That could have been also an argument for seeding, making the chance bigger that I will get an additional defense card to defend myself, but as I said, the resource will come in handy quite a bit. So I was kind of hoping that I maybe don't get hit by an aggression, but it's definitely a dangerous situation, and then I went for the ocean liner service and for the cannons. So with building the knights I get out of corruption, and now you can see why the resource is so important. It allows me to finish the ocean liner service at the next turn, and that should be quite strong. Then I have 6 resource production, 4 science production, and I can still do 2 upgrades. I have the ocean liner service for population, and thanks to Eleanor I actually have a little bit at least of a culture lead at the moment. Even though I got hit by this aggression earlier, I still have a somewhat decent position, I think. But of course it could be that I get hit by an additional aggression now, and that could be quite bad. There is also selective breeding on the row, but I think the ocean liner service is perfect for me, because I still don't have the most science and I still need a government form. So for example, now I could maybe finish the ocean liner service at the next turn, and in 2 turns I will have 12 science available, meaning that I then can go for an H2 government form if one should be available. So the next 2 turns could give me quite a boost if it, for example, happens like this. I draw 1 more blunder. One reason why I kind of was willing to I can't really go for enough strength unless I delete something and maybe go for second knight, reveal the Asars, but I think that would be too costly. But I also had some knowledge about some aggressions. I think both H2 raids were already out now that Thamyris went for 1 raid. I think I also had knowledge about 1 blunder, now about another blunder, so there are maybe at least not the worst H2 aggressions left, but definitely some, and also definitely some that could still be annoying, so I was kind of afraid of Thamyris' politics phase. Footloop doesn't go for the revolution, instead he grabs the revolutionary idea, with that he maybe can go for conmon peacefully, especially because he also has the breakthrough. He also goes for Bach, but he still doesn't use Columbus, so It looks like even though he got that many draws in, he maybe still hasn't drawn a nice colony for Columbus. But he takes Bach in hand to replace Columbus as soon as he uses him, and he also has dramas in hand, so like this, he definitely has a way to get quite a bunch of cultural production going, especially with the big food production that he has. A lot of food production, and maybe he can just build a bunch of dramas with that. As you saw, Timorous actually ceded and didn't go for an aggression, so I was very relieved to see this. The immigration is revealed and we all gained one additional population out of this. And then Timorous goes for two upgrades to coal, has now all mines upgraded. This is at 9 resource production, takes the urban growth and engineering genius, so even more resource cards in hand. Could have maybe thought about journalism at the next turn, he for example could build one, but no, those resource cards of course also might be quite valuable. This turn I can seed one more time with Eleanor. As I said, I'm still the weakest, but it's just quite nice to get some more card draws in. I could maybe still draw a better H2 tactic, and in general some nice events or stuff, so I was willing to seed. And seeded a freedom of movement into the deck. The knowledge of the ancients is revealed, that actually gives me the most now that I took the ocean liner service. No, this turn I thought that I want to go for this Anthony Gaudi. There's also Nobel in the row, which could of course also be an option, but I saw that Footloop went for Bach, so he probably just wants to go for a bunch of cultural production, and I just thought that it might be the best if I just do the same. Because with the hussars and with only having the knights at the moment, I mean I have the cannons, but if I go for hussars, the cannons won't do that much for me. I don't really have the necessary pieces together in my hand to maybe go for a military push. So if Putloop goes for a lot of Bach, for Bach with a bunch of dramas, then I probably can't keep up with the cultural production if I go for Nobel. Of course then I'm maybe a little bit better with my economy, but I just thought that it might just be better if I go also for culture myself, if I just keep up with that. And so I went for Anthony Gaudi here. Also he is of course available for one civil action cheaper. I could think about keeping Eleanor. I can maybe discard 3 cards, then she would still score me 3 additional culture, which is more than Gaudi produces me, but this turn I want to use her additional civil actions, so I replace Eleanor. I still have 5 civil actions left, so I would have now the option to finish the ocean liner service. However, I thought that it is more important to take the Conmon this turn. First of all, it guarantees me that I can go for this government format my next turn, and it might also be quite nice to have the additional military actions available, even though I have the Colosseum. And also, I thought it is maybe important to deny this from Timorous. Timorous has enough science, can go for a government form. Of course, it could be that I can just go for Republic at his next turn, but the thing is, he has no strategy yet, it could get denied, and he also has only 3 military actions, and one of those is from the Open Borders Agreement, meaning that when he goes into H3, it could definitely happen that he goes into H3 with only 2 military actions, and he's very heavily committed to swordsmen, doesn't have any other military tech, and I think that could cause some big issues for him. And he definitely has the biggest economy going, especially if he also gets his government form in. Yeah, but then maybe if he doesn't have the military actions, it at least makes sure that he maybe can't go for an easy military push or something like this. And that should maybe hopefully make me safe. Maybe perhaps also Footloop, because he maybe also plans to go for a big culture push. But no, I just thought it might is probably important to take that away from Timorous, and also it guarantees me that I can go for a government form, and that I have quite a nice amount of military actions available as well. Then of course I can't finish the ocean liner service this turn, but maybe I can go get some upgrades in this turn. This turn I also definitely wanted to make sure that I can't, that I'm not in danger of an aggression any longer, so I went for one knight and revealed the hussar's tactic going up to 9 strength, so I'm not the weakest any longer, and I'm finally not in any danger of an aggression. Then I kinda would like to maybe just go for 2 upgrades, both of my iron and my alchemy, but sadly then I'm missing one resource to go for the ocean liner service the next turn, so I have to decide which upgrade I want to get in now. First I thought that I want to go for an iron upgrade, because finishing the ocean liner service and then maybe also going for operas, because I will grab this copy of opera at my turn, that will require a lot of resources. At least I have somewhat fine science production, I also have this breakthrough in hand, so I thought that maybe just going for the iron upgrade is best. But then I realized that this architecture is coming down the row, and I think there's even a set. No, there's not a second copy left, but there is this one architecture on the row. Tamuro's only has few civil actions. Footloop has a bunch of cards in hand. I mean, he will probably develop Conmon, so both of them could definitely grab the architecture, but I thought there is maybe a chance that it will be available for me at my turn, and then I thought that I kinda want to be prepared for it. And even if I go for the iron upgrade, I still have enough science to go for it. I could develop the Conmon, I will have 15 science, so I would have 3 science left, thanks to the breakthrough, actually 6 science left, so I could go for Conmon and architecture at my next turn, even if I don't upgrade the lab. The problem is that then at the turn after this, I have only 4 science left. And I thought that ideally I want to finish the ocean liner service at the next turn, and then at the turn after that I just wanted to get my culture reduction going with going for some operas, or one opera. And if I only have 4 science available in 2 turns, then I am missing 1 science to go for opera. And because of this, I made a decision to go for this upgrade to the lab. However, it's also not completely safe or completely better, because if I miss out on the architecture, then it could be that I don't have enough resources available, because then if I finish the ocean liner service, I will have 7 resources available in 2 turns, and that's of course, if I don't get the architecture, 1 resource too few to go for the opera. But at least in this H2 deck, there is the arms industry that I see that, so that could potentially help me out. It's definitely possible that it is revealed in 2 turns, and then I hopefully will be able to go for an opera in 2 turns as well, even if I should miss out on the architecture. Now, and then I have to get out of corruption, so I just built 1 stage of the ocean liner service. It still allows me to use the architecture very nicely if it should be available. And then as I said, I will grab this opera. There's also in journalism, but I just think I will need the happy faces. I don't really have the enough happy faces to justify the journalism. So instead I rather went for the opera here. And also we have to be careful, because there's only 1 copy of Organized Religion left, and none of the other players has any happy face solution. Footloop only has the drama with Bach, and so it could definitely be that I miss out on Organized Religions, and then it might even be more important to at least get some additional happy faces in with the opera. I draw the terrorism, but at the moment I'm the culture lead, so I don't really want to see this. Footloop finally uses Columbus, and he definitely got a bit unlucky there. He has a backup colony in hand, a wealthy territory one, but he really had a lot of draws, even took the development of politics, also got 1 card from the call to arms, so it definitely was quite likely that he maybe draws 1 H2 colony, so that's definitely a bit unfortunate for him, but at least the 6 resources actually won't be too bad for him, because that will allow him, after he elects Bach, to go for 2 resources to scientific method this turn, so at least the resources do something. Maybe he even has another colony and still went for the wealthy one, even though I think if he has an H2 colony he probably would go for this, but the resources I think are not too bad for him here, because he still has some bronze mines and it allows him to get those quick upgrades in. And then he also builds a 4th mine, he has a bunch of population available and maybe just wants to have some additional resource production. He stays the weakest, so that's maybe good news for me. And Timurus again goes for an aggression, this time for the spy. And both of them have an open borders agreement, so he actually has 12 strength when he goes for the aggression, but Footloop has 1 defense card and is able to defend himself. Timuru skipped the journalism at the last turn, but this time he will go for 1, and he just invests all of the resource, or he invests all of the civil actions in it to go for this. He still has quite a bunch of resources left, but like this, he is now at 7 science production, so he really is a strong economy, just is missing a government form. But as when he goes for Republic and doesn't get a strategy, that definitely might cause some issues for him. Also, I was happy to see it, because with him going for journalism, that will mean that the architecture is available for me at my turn. Also, with not being the weakest, I can maybe push this turn, and with at least having a tactic available, the other player still didn't reveal any tactic. I thought that I maybe can justify pushing this Cold War in, I have some time to prepare for it, I will get some population with the ocean liner service, so I was hoping that I can manage to be one of the 2 strongest. The Pestilence is revealed, sadly I don't have a free population, that would have been better to see after I have finished the ocean liner service, but it's also not too bad. I can maybe just lose this warrior, that leaves me with 1 strength less. It's not ideal, especially if I should draw a tactic where I then still need infantry units, but isn't completely bad for me yet. Immediately it doesn't disrupt me or something like this. This turn I can go for the Conmon using the breakthrough with the Silk Road, and then I can also go for the Architecture, finish the Ocean Liner service. I could, before I use the Ocean Liner service to increase my population, I could still use the Frugality, because then I could increase my population, getting maybe one more population out, but I actually kind of needed all of my three civil actions, because I think one very important pick here is to go for the Organized Religion. As I said earlier, that is the last Happy Face solution left, meaning that both Footloop and Timurus don't really have a Happy Face solution available, and it also could definitely cause some big issues for them, and yeah, so I think it's very important to take that. It will be might be helpful for myself, can develop it for cheaper with Godi, maybe after I already went for the Opera I can get some very cheap upgrades in for only two resources, I can upgrade my religion, making sure that I have more free population to maybe put population into military, so I think that's a very important pick, and instead of using the frugality I also rather wanted to get this breakthrough, because I think with the Silk Route it gives me 4 science and it's just quite a lot and I might need quite a bunch of science. I also thought about the reserves, because I also might need a bunch of resources, but I thought science is probably more important. And I draw some more cards, Grimewave, inhabited territory and international agreement. Footloop goes for dramas now, otherwise there's the risk that the age will end before his next turn, but he doesn't build a drama yet, instead grabs the coal, grabs the rich land and the urban growth, so he probably wants to go for coal so the next turn can use the urban growth to then maybe build a drama. Interestingly, he skips in the wave, that definitely I think could have been an option instead of one of those two cards, because he is still the weakest, definitely has to build some military at some point, so maybe that could be an idea instead of the urban growth, but of course it also takes one more civil action to play, so no. And maybe he just wants to get one drama and one upgrade in as quickly as possible. And if he doesn't take the urban growth, he can't go for an upgrade and for a drama. Timurus tries another aggression, this time the infiltrate, that of course could have been quite huge, infiltrating Bach. But sadly Footloop has one more aggression, one more defense card in hand, meaning he can defend against the aggression. And yeah, he definitely also had quite a bunch of those, had sent one away for the colony to... For defending himself, but I mean he didn't draw a colony, so at least he gets something in return. Timurus this turn goes for the Republic, and there's also the strategy in the road that he can take. He has an uprising at the moment because of the pestilence, but he does something very interesting here. He actually just goes for the Harvard College, disbanding one swordsman. Now, I mean, it gets him up to 10 science production immediately, so that is really, really huge. But, I mean, he misses out on the strategy, and he has to disband a swordsman, so I'm really not sure if it is worth it. Maybe he could have taken it and then just increased population, taking the strategy, making sure that he has this available, and then maybe he would have corruption, but he can finish it at the next turn. I think that would be the much safer play, because now he will be at 2 military actions, and that is quite annoying. Missing out on draws, being very vulnerable to military, always having to be very careful about military, and... yeah, so I'm really not convinced by this turn. It fits a little bit to the playstyle of Timurus. Timurus is really willing to just go for the economy and don't be too much concerned about other stuff. So it definitely fits to his playstyle, and he definitely gets some good results out of this with this. But in this scenario, I just think he has to pick the strategy, because he has that much science, even if he doesn't finish the Harvard College immediately, and the strategy could just help him really a lot. Then this turn I seed a Crime Wave. I'm actually the only player who has seeded any events into the next deck, so that's quite nice to have the knowledge. And I mean, the Cold War's already in, so at least I want to be one of the two strongest. Maybe I will only also manage to be the strongest. And yeah, the other events I didn't really want to seed, but I am the strongest at the moment, so I kind of wanted to push. So yeah, I seeded a Crime Wave, and the Arms Industry is revealed, giving everyone two additional resources. This turn I can use the Ocean Liner service, I can use the develop the Opera using the breakthrough for 4 science with the Silk Road, and then I can build one, just getting me up to 9 culture production. I still have a culture lead, and like this I hopefully will also make this culture lead a little bit bigger, depending on how many dramas Footloop will build. Yeah. And then I have a bunch of civil actions left, and I just wanted to have the strategy, definitely also a little bit as a denial. I mean, it could also be nice for myself, but I already have a bunch of military actions, not the most science production, so it's maybe not ideal for myself, but both Footloop and Temerus really have lots of science production, and yeah, Footloop probably would take it away from Temerus, but there's maybe a chance that he would let it through, and I think I definitely want to avoid that Temerus gets this strategy. Then I still have three civil actions left. I took the efficient upgrade. I thought about if I maybe want to use this for this mine upgrade, but at the end I made a decision to actually upgrade this mine. This turn I grabbed a rifleman just to be prepared for more tactics, because I didn't draw another tactic yet than the hussars, but yeah, the hussars could definitely be fine, especially if I could should maybe get tanks. Yeah, the frugality isn't really needed, and I just wanted to spend my last civil action somehow. I didn't really want to develop any of those cards that I have in hand, and so I just did this upgrade. Efficient upgrade I can maybe use to upgrade my religion to organized religion, but it would also be a little bit costly because it's very cheap anyway. But I mean, I have the ocean liner service, I might get into consumption at some point, and maybe if I take the selective breeding, then the efficient upgrade will allow myself to get one farm upgrade in for free. Then I get some more draws, and I draw the defensive army, not ideal for myself, but very nice to have the knowledge that the other players don't have it. Footloop has Great Wall, has two swordsmen, Demeris has four swordsmen, so that's very nice knowledge to have that both of those players don't have the defensive army available. H3 starts, and no, Footloop seats while being the weakest, and there's no strength event, but still a nice event for me. It is the emigration, meaning that both Footloop and Demeris will lose one population at their turn. And interestingly, Footloop goes for the Suez Canal, won't start building on that this turn, instead goes for two upgrades to coal, that is now possible, I think, thanks to the coal to arms, and maybe there was something else, because I actually thought that he didn't have that many resources. No, but he can go for two upgrades to coal, increases his population. And that actually means that he can't finish the Suez Canal at the next turn, so that is quite interesting. It will be quite late, I mean, he will have three colonies if he has one in hand, and definitely we have to assume that. So it is, will definitely be a decent Suez Canal, but the reason why I thought that he goes for the Suez Canal is that the colony that he has in hand helps him with his happy faces. So either that he maybe has inhabited or vast, but I have inhabited, so maybe vast. Or maybe even historic territory too. Both of them could really help him a lot in case pro sports are late, or yeah, because at the moment he only has those dramas, so that could really be helpful, and that I think might be the reason why he goes for that, even though he will finish it relatively late. But he skips the cavalryman, meaning that he has only cannons in hand at the moment. Temerus has to fix this uprising. He only can do this if he doesn't want to delete anything with increasing his population two times. He's willing to grab the military build up for three. Could maybe think about going for Churchill because he already has upgraded all of his mines, but of course there is the potential that he maybe can go for oil or mechanized agriculture with James Watt. And then he also grabs the Patriotism. I think that's a very important card for him, just because of the additional military action that he will get. But he also doesn't take Cavalryman, doesn't take Rifleman, just will sit on those Swordsmen. That's definitely a little bit greedy. On the other hand, I mean, both me and Footloop just have Goody, have Bach, so we maybe want to just go for a bunch of cultural production anyway, and because of that, maybe Temerus doesn't really feel threatened. Then it's my turn, I see the civil unrest, I'm still the strongest, so I want to push. Also that means that I have knowledge about four events in the next deck. The Ravages of Time is revealed, that makes it a little bit awkward with the civil service, because I will lose one happy face from the Colosseum. Otherwise it's not that bad to lose the Colosseum, I still have a fine amount of military actions, but the happy face at the moment is a little bit annoying, because what I actually wanted to do is to build one more opera this turn. And no. But before all of that, there are also some technologies that I want to grab. First of all, the Cavalryman. I could have already taken them at the last turn, because both of my opponents still needed it, but I thought it's for two. I mean, it could also be helpful for Hussars, but now that's actually the last copy of Cavalryman, and still, both of my opponents don't have those Cavalrymen, and now I have also drawn the defensive army, meaning that yeah, they don't have this tactic available, so I thought it's quite important that I deny the Cavalryman here, so that they have to wait for the tanks, and maybe I can even take one of the tanks away as well. And then, of course, I also really want to take the air forces. I have the culture lead at the moment, and maybe just going for even more culture, building an opera now, maybe another one at the next turn with the architecture. Just hopefully might give me a culture lead that I then hopefully can defend with the air forces. Then, as I said, I still made the decision to build one opera. I thought about if I maybe want to go for organized religion, making sure that I don't have any unhappy faces. The thing is, if I don't go for the opera, I miss out on 3 culture. And now if I should get hit by civil unrest, I lose 4 culture, but at least I get a 3 addition culture reduction, so then it would basically only be -1, and it's definitely not guaranteed that the civil unrest will be revealed, so I was willing to take that risk, and at the next turn maybe I can just build another opera that fixes my happy faces for one turn, and then at the turn after that I can maybe go for organized religion if the civil unrest should still be in the deck and if I should need the happy faces. I have a full hand, so if I want to use some of my civil actions, I have to develop something, and I made a decision to develop the strategy that make sure that I'm the strongest, which could be important, because if Footloop should get stronger and then Timur recedes, then I wouldn't be part of the Cold War, also there's the crime wave in, so I think getting stronger is quite nice. Now I'm relatively low in science, I was concerned about this, especially because I will not even take one more technology into my hand. That definitely could be an issue, that I have too many techs in hand, it causes hand space issues, and I at the moment definitely have enough, don't have enough science to go for all of those techs. But I still thought that I want to have the selective breeding, because otherwise I relatively soon have to build 2 farms once I get into this area of the Yellow Bank. And with building 2 farms, it just isn't that efficient, and I rather wanted to maybe have those workers available for military, because if one of the other players goes for a military push, then those workers could be quite important, and because of that I was willing to go for the selective breeding, or to at least take it in hand to have the option to go for it. I also tried out some turns where I go for selective breeding already this turn, maybe making it that I can actually get also one more population out just with because of the food production one turn earlier, but I figured that even if I go for it at the next turn, I just will get one more population out thanks to the selective breeding, to the one upgrade. I draw one war, so that could give me some options. Also the impact of tech. The impact of tech is maybe rather nice to note that my opponents don't have it, because both of them really have lots of science production. Footloop destroys the library with the Ravages of Time, uses Bach and goes for one drama. Then after this elects Bill Gates and then just goes for 2 more dramas. So that's interesting, and I definitely could imagine that Bach is a little bit annoyed. He was leading the civilization and wasn't allowed to build any dramas, and then Bill Gates takes over and he builds 3 dramas immediately. So I think Bach is annoyed by this, but of course it makes sense for Footloop to go for the Bill Gates getting even more resource production and being able to build up a very strong economy. Just going for some culture reduction with Bach could be an idea. But there is also this copy of computers in the row, so he probably really doesn't want to leave this combination to Tamuris. And instead of taking the computers, Footloop just uses Bill Gates with the scientific method. Once he finishes the Suez Canal, will build 15 resource production, that might just be enough. And so he maybe doesn't really need to grab the computers. He remains the weakest for now, so that's nice for the Cold War and the crime wave that is in there. Timurus takes the urban growth, and because of the Rome roads, he actually has an uprising issue because of the missing yellow token. And he has to fix this somehow, and he will go for movies this turn, builds one, builds another one, and then is willing to even destroy one lab. Goes up to 14 culture production. So he, without having the defensive army, with only being 2 military actions, he of course sees that he kind of doesn't really have any chances to maybe go for a big military push, way how he wants to catch up is just with starting culture production as well, and he's very strong production, can maybe go for an additional movie at the next turn, and could definitely start catching up somehow. Also, he still doesn't have a real happy face solution, and there's one leader that could help with the happy faces, which is Chaplin, so with that he also prepares for that leader and just gets a lot of culture production up. I'm the strongest, so I want to seed, and I seeded the international agreement, and it will take a while until this will be open, so I was hoping that it should be fine. Sadly, the economic progress is revealed, it isn't really the event that I wanted to see, First of all, it's just a nice event for my opponents, and sadly, I will go for the selective breeding now, but because of the one food that I lose here, that will mean that I probably won't get an additional population out, thanks to the additional food production, because now I'm only at plus one, and it much just might take too long until I have enough food to maybe increase my population also one time. Normally, it's maybe not the biggest deal. Maybe having less food even helps me with corruption a little bit, but yeah, I still would have liked to maybe have the option to get also one population out normally at some point. Now, I go for selective breeding this turn, just making sure that I don't have to build any farm, meaning that I have more workers available for other things. Also, I can use the efficient upgrade like this and can get this upgrade for free. Then I want to build one more opera that makes sure that at least for one turn I'm not in any danger of the civil unrest, and I take the reserves and the revolutionary idea, taking some more yellow cards for the Silk Road. Could also think about, of course, about taking two reserves. There is at least a Cold War in there, but even with the Cold War I have many technologies in hand. If I maybe draw an H3 tactic, then it could be very important to have the science to develop a bunch of military technologies and maybe also some other technologies. So I think the revolutionary idea is more important than taking a second copy of reserves here. And I actually have an interesting draw. I draw another war and also the mechanized army. So that could maybe be an idea to prepare to go for a war with this tactic, but it also will require quite a lot of science. At least I have the rough idea now, but even with that, it would still take a while until I would be set up for this, but it's a nice option to have in hand, and I definitely was thinking about if I maybe can make this work. Woodloop offers the international tourism to me, and I wasn't 100% sure if I should accept it, because we both have three wonders. But Footloop isn't for certain that he will finish the Suez Canal already this turn, so he will maybe get like 3, 4, or maybe even 5 more culture out of this than me. But I get even more culture out of this compared to Tamiris, and I thought both of them have definitely chances to catch up. I thought that maybe Footloop has a little bit of a better position, so I was a little bit more concerned about him, because he also, you know, with the military theory, has many military actions. He will also have quite a strong economy, even more resource production than Tamiris. And so I was maybe more afraid of him, and because of that I thought if I maybe should reject it, but at the end I just accepted it and took the additional culture that I get against Tamiris. Then Footloop goes for the military theory, develops the cannons as well, and then grabs the computers, builds one cannon to at least have not full corruption, builds one stage of the Suez Canal, maybe plans on finishing that at the next turn. Tamiris goes for the civil service. He still has lots of science, so he can afford to invest some of those science into the civil service. He also will go for rockets, will increase his population, build one rocket, is now at 13 strength, meaning I'm now the weakest, meaning that I definitely don't want to cede at my next turn. And then he takes the oil and builds one more movie, going up to 18 culture production. And with having that many movies, and with Fleming and Chaplin being in the game, he definitely is prepared to go for quite a big Hollywood. So that could definitely be a way how he can catch up a lot of culture. So I have to be careful about this. Also interesting that he takes the oil and not the reserves. Of course he has James Watt, and those upgrades are very cheap from coal to oil. Only one resource per upgrade. On the other hand, he probably wants to get still additional military actions, and if he invests science into military theory, then I'm not sure if he actually has the science for the oil. I think if he has impact of industry or something in hand, then maybe it makes sense, but otherwise maybe it would just be the safer call to take the reserves. And he also will reveal a tactic. I was not too happy about this. First of all, that means that he has now a tactic that he can use, at the moment only outdated, but with the potential to fully fulfill it later. And it also means that Footloop can copy this, so as soon as he gets modern infantry, or even maybe he can also use it outdated. So I wasn't happy about his tactic reveal, but of course from Tamiris' perspective it makes sense, because he has to use his military actions very carefully, and he also can only keep few cards in hand, so that yeah, makes of course sense for him to reveal this. Then, yeah, at my turn, I had now this mechanized army and a war in hand, so yeah. I thought that it is the best for me to start preparing for this. There is also a multimedia on the rose, who definitely could be an option to just build a multimedia, get even more culture production going. The problem is, Footloop has now 7 military actions, he has the positional army now available in 2 turns, and he definitely, with his big resource production, has quite a big potential to go for a lot of military. So I think I have to be quite careful here and have to prepare for military anyway, and if I do this anyway, then maybe I can even to try to prepare it like this, that I maybe can even go for war on my own. However, I can't prepare for the next turn, it isn't really possible, but in 2 turns there might just still be H3, it could get close, but it might still be H3 in 2 turns, definitely likely, but Timorous, with having many civil actions, could maybe force to anti-H. And so I thought that I maybe want to prepare to be potentially able to go for war in 2 turns. I developed the organized religion, I really need the happy faces now, also the civil unrest is still in the deck. I played a revolutionary idea to get the one additional science of the Silk Road, and I definitely need the science to develop a military attack. I go for the cannons here, I could go for some different technologies, but at the end I made the decision to go for the cannons first. I can build one cannon, another cannon, making sure that I'm the strongest. And then I take all of the yellow cards, just getting a lot of resources into my hand. I probably don't even need all of the yellow cards to go for the war in 2 turns, but I maybe that makes it possible that I can go for a war and then even still have enough resources to finish a wonder at my last turn. So I just was happy to get all of those yellow cards for one civil action each, and no. There's one thing that I need to make this war work, and that is that before my second next turn, I have to be part of the Cold War, otherwise I don't have enough science, or I have to get a revolutionary idea. There are still 2 copies left, but I think it's definitely not unlikely that at least one of those 2 things will happen, and with that I could definitely have the chance to pull this war off and go for 2 mechanized armies with air forces, and Tamurus, with being only on 2 military actions, it might be difficult for him to defend. And I already have quite a bunch of culture production going, so even though I invest into military now, I still have the most culture production and I have quite a big lead, but I already had 1 production more now, so it's not a perfect time to take a look at the overview. Footloop sees an impact and a crime wave is revealed. I really would have loved to see the Cold War, but I also won't complain about a crime wave because I'm the strongest at the moment and won't be part of this. Footloop this turn finally will finish the Suez Canal, meaning that I will get 1 more culture production thanks to the international tourism, and he has the vast territory too with the Suez Canal, and as I said, he probably took the Suez Canal so that will help him with the happy faces, and he definitely does. He has now a lot more population available that he can maybe put into military or into something else. Yeah, and he will build 1 cannon, another cannon that gets him out of corruption, make sure that he is the strongest. Then it's Timurus' turn, and he will still go for oil with James Watt, goes for 1 upgrade. Then after this goes for Chaplin, and will go for modern infantry and a revolutionary idea. So, yeah, sadly this copy of revolutionary idea is taken away, and the Cold War isn't revealed yet, so I wasn't really sure if my war plan at the end will work, but no. There's maybe still hope, because Timurus at least didn't get stronger, making it possible that I maybe can win the Cold War at my turn. And I definitely wanted to try this, so I see the impact of population, and that one hopefully should be quite nice for me, or at least relatively equal, so that it's seedable. And there's indeed a Cold War. I was very happy about this, because that really makes it sure that I have the science, so that I can really plan my next turn out and don't have to account for the different possibilities of if I win the Cold War and if I don't win the Cold War, and now I can fully commit to this. So that's very nice to see the Cold War revealed. And this turn was quite a difficult one and quite a big of a puzzle. Because I can prepare for war the next turn, but Timurus has many resources, has modern infantry in hand, and he definitely could have issues with the military actions, but it's definitely possible that in the next 2 turns he can make sure that he can defend himself. So actually it is quite likely that even if I prepare for war, he maybe can at least threaten to defend enough against me, if he gets the military theory, but it's likely that he will get this at some point. Yeah, so you could maybe also just say, let's play a normal turn, make sure that I can defend myself, take a bunch of cards, and then it's quite likely maybe that the age will end. And then with my culture lead, and maybe with also preparing myself that I can maybe take and finish a wonder like Fast Food Chains, United Nations, or Hollywood, then I can maybe make sure that I can get a wonder at my next turn, and maybe the age will end, and that could maybe also just be a fine approach, but there is one problem, and that problem is the Hollywood. Because if the age would end already at the next turn, then Tamurus probably can, when the Hollywood is available at his turn, take the Hollywood, still make sure that the age will end, and no. And then he just gets a very big Hollywood. Already at this point, the Hollywood is worth quite more than 30 culture. He at least will it be able to make it more than 40 culture. If he somehow gets an additional urban building slot, then he might even be able to make it more bigger than 50 culture. So that would be quite a big Hollywood, and with that I think Tamurus actually would have good chances to catch up. So I kind of wanted to make sure that Tamurus can't go for the Hollywood. And because of that, that was the reason why I still really wanted to prepare for this war. Making sure that Tamurus has to prepare to defend himself, because he can't defend easily. He has to spend his next turn then defending. But hopefully that he doesn't have enough civil actions to take the Hollywood and to also set up a defense. I was hoping that if he takes the Hollywood, that I then can punish him with the war. And if he prepares for war, that he doesn't get the Hollywood, so that maybe I or Footloop can take it away at a turn after. So yeah. So with that, I really wanted to make sure that the age won't end, and I wanted to prepare for war. And I made a decision to not touch the row, or at least not apart from those two slots. That makes sure that the air forces stay in 3 for Footloop. That makes it more difficult for him to take it, and with that it makes it more likely that he will take less cards from the row. Because if he gets air force for 2 and maybe he takes 1 or 2 cards in addition to that, then Tamurus already can relatively easily end the age and still take the Hollywood. So I think I really have to let this air force stay on 3, and it also makes it more expensive for Footloop to take it. If I prepare for war, I think Footloop is kind of forced to take it, and it maybe also prevents him from doing some other useful stuff. I kinda tried to set up for this war with going for one upgrade to my farms, because that would mean that at my next turn I can increase my population once normally and once with the ocean liner service, hopefully making sure that I don't have to delete anything. And it almost works out, but it didn't really work out. I really tried a lot of different stuff, and at the end the reason why it didn't work out is because I have the architecture. Of course, that's only part of the reason, but it actually is one part of the reason. Because I wanted to make some different things for certain. First of all, I wanted to make note is that the freedom of movement is in the deck, so I have to plan my next turn for when the freedom of movement is revealed and when it isn't revealed. Yeah, and I wanted to make sure that if somehow the other players manage to end the age, which I thought is very unlikely, but if this should happen, I want to be able to just take and finish a wonder at my next turn. So that was one goal that I wanted to achieve. The next goal that I of course wanted to achieve is that I can go for a war even if the freedom of movement isn't revealed. And the third goal that I wanted to achieve is that if the freedom of movement is revealed, that I then can go for a war and still have enough resources to finish the fast food chains. And for this last scenario, I just was missing one resource if I go for this farm upgrade, because then I would go for air forces. If the freedom of movement is revealed, I could put this lab into air forces, and if I wouldn't have this architecture, then this lab would be worth one more resource, because for the freedom of movement, the discounts of the architecture are taken into account. So if this would be cost 6 resources, then I would get basically one more resource out of the freedom of movement, and then it would be possible for me to go for a war with the freedom of movement and still have enough resources to go for a wonder. Also, I wanted to make sure that I can at my next turn go for a war with only using 3 civil actions, so that I then have 4 civil actions left to take the fast food chains, if the fast food chains are available. And I thought that it is definitely possible, because the other players might be concerned with defending against a potential war from me. Yeah, so that was quite a difficult turn, a lot of things to take into account. And as I said, sadly it didn't work out that I can upgrade this form. Of course, I thought about maybe putting a farm with the freedom of movement into air forces, then I would get one more resource, but then I would miss this farm and it didn't really work out nicely. So I sadly have to miss out on this, and that might mean that I have to do a disband, especially if the freedom of movement isn't revealed. And now, I played the reserves for additional resources. I went for one air force, I disbanded the Royal, went for one cannon. I play the reserves, I still don't, I'm not in corruption, and I take the tanks, and then I actually will just float my last three civil actions, because, yeah, as I said, if I only take one card, then it already could definitely happen that Timorous can't anti-age, so, and it also makes the life of Footloop quite a bit easier, because, no, I think with Air Forces and Tui, maybe can do a bit more stuff, which could definitely be make a difference for him. Like this, I have 13 resources. At the next turn I could play the reserves, take a Wonder, either Fast Food Chains for 1, or Hollywood or United Nations for 2, and just take and finish it, if the age should end, which is quite unlikely. And I have enough resources to go for war, even if the freedom of movement isn't revealed, and with taking those tanks, if the freedom of movement is revealed, then I can maybe just go for tanks instead of the cavalryman. At least I have this option to go up for more strength without needing to build another military unit, making it that I don't have to delete anything, or apart from putting this alchemy maybe into cannon or air forces with the freedom of movement if this should be revealed. But I could also make the decision to not go for the tanks, instead go for the cavalryman, and then I could use the freedom of movement and still have enough resources to finish a wonder at the last turn. As I said earlier, I actually didn't really expect that I can pull off this war. I thought that Tamiris probably has a shot at defending himself. But, as I said, the main goal of this is to achieve the Tamiris can't take the Hollywood at the next turn, because he has to prepare himself for defense. And yeah, so that was quite a difficult turn, and I hope I could at least a little bit explain my thought process to you. And interestingly, Footloop will go for a war against Timorous. He can go for air forces, he can increase his population 2 times, build 2 air forces, and he still has 1 civil action left to destroy a mine, builds 1 cannons, and reveals the entrenchments tactic is now at 57 strength, so that kind of worked out very nicely for him. He's just enough civil actions, just enough military actions. So he goes for a war, but he can't do anything else. So I actually thought that that might be a nice outcome for me, because it even more makes sure that Timorous has to defend himself, making it more likely that he won't get the Hollywood, and with that, hopefully I can keep my culture lead. But if Timorous doesn't defend nicely, then of course Footloop also steals quite a bunch of culture, which could definitely also be quite bad. The Hollywood is indeed in the rose. Let's see if Timorous can take it. First of all, he will play the patriotism, military buildup, and another patriotism. Playing both patriotism definitely helps him to be able to use some military actions. He can increase his population, get 1 more rocket in, and then he just goes for as many upgrades as he has military actions, going up to 39 strength. So there are definitely some culture will be stolen. And then he builds 1 more journalism. Actually, that additional science is quite important, because that will make it possible that he can go for democracy at the next turn. It also makes it possible that he can go for military theory without having to play the revolutionary idea. In case of a war, that could maybe make a difference. Maybe also not. He has a bunch of civil actions, but it could still be nice, so that he maybe can go for war defense and still take a wonder or something like this. So yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And with that, he is at 39 strength, and of course, the very interesting question is now, can he defend against a war now or not? The thing is, the freedom of movement wasn't revealed, and and Timorous, the freedom of movement could be opened before his turn, then he could maybe put something like a coal mine into an H3 military unit, and he could potentially just go for 4 more units. It would be costly, he would have to delete a lot of stuff, but it definitely would be possible. And in this scenario, if he just, for example, goes for 4 more units, and he potentially can even do more, and he also gets the military theory, in this scenario he gets 20 strength from the units, another 12 from the positional army, and it's 32, another 5 from military theory, it's 37, that's 76, and with that he could potentially win the war, and with that, I made a decision to not go for war. But at least he couldn't take the Hollywood, which maybe also was because Footloop went for the war now. Maybe he also couldn't really go for it. If he goes for the Hollywood, Yeah, he definitely can't use all of those patriotisms, and then it might be possible for me to go for a war, and so that I can punish this. Yeah, but like this, he didn't get to Hollywood, and I made a decision that a war is too risky. Maybe he would actually not defend enough. Maybe he would, try to rather maximize the culture. But it definitely could be that he just thinks, "Nah, I will want to win this war. It's a big swing." This turn, I see the Iconoclasm in. It could just be nice because I will just lose Goldie, and maybe I will go for Fleming at the next turn. But if it is revealed in H3, maybe it will remove Chaplin from Tamiris, and maybe that costs him 4 culture, and maybe causes even some happy face issues. The freedom of movement is revealed, which is a little bit dangerous. I had to think about if this could be a problem. Because this turn I will prepare myself for military, we can also take a look at this. I will go for tanks, one cannon, play the patriotism, go for those two upgrades, reveal the tactic going up to 60 strength. But I actually have only 12 plus 5, 17 resources, meaning that I maybe could go for one more air force, one more tank. That would put me at something like plus 20 strength. Could, of course, potentially maybe also build one more knight like this, so potentially 22, it would be 82. But if the modern infantry is revealed on Footloop's turn, then he could go for two upgrades and with the freedom of movement even more, and then he could actually win the war. So I had to be careful. I still made the decision to cede because there's one specific reason why I think that a war against me is out of the question, or maybe not out of the question, but very dangerous for Footloop. Because if he goes for a war against me, then Tamiris can fully concentrate on culture, meaning that he won't get stronger. He also, it will be H4 this turn, won't get any draws in, meaning that I can go for an aggression for certain against him, meaning that I have the potential with a blunder or raid, and I actually have two raids in hand, I have the potential to get even more resources, to get even more strength, and I think Footloop can't risk this. Also, that would mean that Tamiris fully can concentrate on culture. I think Footloop can't go for a war and take the Hollywood away. So I really thought that it won't be the case, and so I was willing to cede even though the freedom of movement is revealed, which could make a war from Footloop potentially stronger. No, but with the freedom of movement, I can prepare for the civil unrest. If that isn't revealed, then isn't that easy for me to prepare for this, especially after the age will end. So that was the reason why I wanted to push. Either the civil unrest is revealed and it's out, or the freedom of movement is revealed and then it can help me to prepare for this. I put a worker from alchemy into organized religion. I'm weakest for impact of science anyway. I still have at least one left for Gaudi and for impact of variety, so it only makes a difference for the impact of balance. Could make a big difference in case I get an aggression off at the next turn and maybe have some spare resources to go for a farm upgrade, and it could make a big difference for the impact of balance. But I just wanted to be prepared for the civil unrest, and I also wanted to get this one additional culture production. After making sure that I have a reasonable amount of strength that I can defend against an aggression, that I'm hopefully also well prepared for a war, I then went for the fast food chains and the urban growth. I could, of course, take the Hollywood. Tamiris will lose a bunch of culture to the war, but he has this democracy now, meaning that the Hollywood could potentially be worth more than 50 culture for him, which is quite a lot. However, I just thought that Footloop, of course, sees this as well, so I just give up the burden to him. He has to take the Hollywood now, and then because I just think he has to do it. And at least he has the multimedia, so he can also still get a decent amount of culture out of it. I think the fast food chains would be better for him, would leave him more flexible. The Hollywood is also fine for him. I just think that he 100% will deny it. And yeah, so I just went for the better one for myself. That also makes sure that I can go for the urban growth. And at the next turn, I can, for example, go for one organized religion and still finish the fast food chains. Maybe I get some additional resources in if I go for a raid. Maybe I could then go for an upgrade to my farms or something like this, or maybe build something else. But that was the plan for my next turn. I don't draw an impact, but I draw some more aggression, so that could also be very nice. Footloop steals 23 culture from Tamiris. Seeds, and the civil unrest is revealed. No one has any unhappy faces at the moment. And yeah, as I predicted it, Footloop takes the Hollywood, and thanks to the engineering, he can actually get just two multimedias in and finish the Hollywood up until his next turn. So then the Hollywood will still be fine, but his actions are also kind of forced. That's also what I liked about this, because I really thought he has to grab it, and if he has to grab it, his actions are kind of forced. So, unless he maybe has another war. But as I said, Tamaris could defend reasonably well, so Footloop would have to invest quite a lot into this war. Tamaris will now miss out into Hollywood, will go for the democracy, will go for one more movie, there's now 32 cultural productions, so that's quite a lot. He won't go to Hollywood, but at least he will still get a Wonder, the United Nations, and he also will take the multimedias, so maybe he can even go for more cultural production at the next turn. Even after he got hit by a war, he is still only 6 culture behind Footloop, so and he will get another big production, so there we can see how much potential he has, as he would have if we would have let him in peace, especially if he should have gotten to Hollywood. At my turn, I thought about if I could do something nice with the additional resources from either Raid or Occupy, but I didn't really figure out something nice, and so I just went for an armed intervention at my turn. Plaguing Impact of Competition could also be an idea, it very likely should be best for me, but the armed intervention will probably be better. Succeeding makes it more likely that the Iconoclasm will be revealed, but it will only be bad for Tamaris, and if I want something bad for Tamaris, then the aggression also makes more sense. Then I use the Ocean Liner service to increase my population. I have just enough actions to go for Fleming. I can build this religion completely for free thanks to the Silk Road with the Urban Growth, and then I have just enough resources left and actions to finish the fast food chains for 24 points. Then Footloop Seed, sadly no Iconoclasm is revealed, instead the international agreement. And yeah, Footloop has just enough resource to go for one more multimedia, and then he has one resource left after finishing the Hollywood for 24 points, also got some additional cultural production up, and will develop the computers, and also takes a bunch of technologies away. Tamaris dispense unit of swordsmen, and another unit of modern infantry will build 2 farms, which is interesting, and then he finishes the United Nations for 12, and he actually will evaluate an impact of balance, which is plus 16 for him now after building the farm, so that is definitely not bad. It's interesting that he didn't seed, because of course he could have just seeded this event in and got 3 culture from seeding. Maybe he's afraid of the top event, it could be a strength event, and it actually is a banned event for him, the Iconoclasm. It would cost him 4 culture, he would only get 3 for seeding, it also would cause some happy face issues. So maybe he was afraid of a bad event. On the other hand, I think he is still behind, he is not out of the game, he will get still his production, but he is behind, and I think in this position he has to take some risks, so I think he probably should seed this impact in and take the risk of getting hit by something bad, just to have the shot of getting 3 additional culture, and maybe even a nice event. It could also be something nice, so I think he maybe should rather take the risk here. Yeah, and then before the final impacts, I have now a relatively comfortable lead, but both of Footloop and Tamaris have quite booming civilizations, so there could definitely be some strong impacts for them. And Tamaris is only 8 culture behind Footloop still, so he is definitely still in the game. The first impact is the impact of Wonders, 14 for me, 14 for Footloop, and 10 for Tamaris. Then we have the impact of Harmony, 20 for me, 20 for Footloop, and 16 for Tamaris, so those were not great impacts for Tamaris. There's the impact of Variety, 18 for me, 20 for Footloop, and only 10 for Tamaris, so that's a bad impact, another bad impact for him. And then there's the impact that I see, that is the impact of Population, 18 for me, 18 for Footloop, and 14 for Tamaris. Then there will be the Bill Gates bonus, and at the end I'm able to win this game. Footloop is in the second position, and Tamaris finishes at the third position. Yeah, so I'm very happy that I was able to get this win, because especially after I got hit by this plunder at the end of H1, I was quite concerned, because I really didn't know if I had a compensation, but I kinda managed to build up some economy. Getting all of those draws in gave me the enough defense cards to defend against another aggression later and to focus on building up my economy. And then Eleanor really produced me a lot of culture, and I was able to switch to Gaudi, got this ocean liner service, and with that I built up a relatively nice economy while also starting to produce a culture lead. And yeah, at the end it then worked out that I was able to get enough culture. I think Tamaris also definitely had some problems with having no happy face solution, with being added to military actions, so I think he maybe should have played it a little bit differently. Yeah, but even though he had these problems, he really produced a lot of culture, and if there would be no war and if he could just finish the game in peace, I'm really certain that he would maybe finish first. So because of that, there was that very difficult turn where I even floated three civil actions just to make sure that Tamriel can't just end the age and take the Hollywood, that he has to be afraid of a war. Woodloop made this danger even more real because he actually went for war, so that of course also helped. And then Tamriel wasn't able to get the Hollywood, and then I was able to keep my culture lead at the end. So an interesting game. The Colosseum has now already a 100% win rate for me in this season, so maybe I have to consider this more highly now. Silk Road I think also worked out quite nicely. I was able to use quite a bunch of yellow cards, and the science production also was quite useful, and worked out at the end quite nicely for me. Also getting this tactic, being able to put the pressure on the other players and being able to defend myself also was quite nice. I mean, I had a bunch of military technologies in hand, I would have also been prepared for other tactics, even though if I also would have to develop the Rifeman, it could have been close with the science. But so I could have maybe also drawn a different tactic and do something with it, but a mechanized army definitely was one that was maybe the easiest to make work for me, so that was definitely quite nice. Yeah, and after having one more win, we can also take a look at the standings, because there are also two games finished up to this point where I wasn't involved. And we can see that there was one game where Footloop finished with a 2-culture lead before Aaron Green, so a very close game, and the last place Watsinius, so that's maybe a little bit surprising, but Watsinius was then immediately able to win his second game before Aaron Green and Tamriel's, and that make the standings look like this. I'm on top, I had quite a nice start with winning my first two games, so I'm very happy about the start, of course. Footloop and Aaron Green both have already all games of the first batch finished. Footloop has one second place and one third place, being at 7 points, and Aaron Green takes up Payada's role with not finishing first and not finishing last, with having 3 second places, and he is at 6 points. So maybe for both of them an average start, definitely not bad, but also not great, but for both of them a fine start into the season, or fine first half of the season. Watsinius has 2 games finished, and he is at 5 points. The next game of me will be against him, and of course if he wins this game, if I lose it, then he already has catched me, so he is definitely, even though he lost one game, definitely is still in a good position and could come back very quickly. And Antimerus had a bad start. He needs to perform, get some better results in the next games. He finished with 2 third places. Could have maybe finished at a better position if he would have gotten to Hollywood at the last game, but sadly for him that didn't work out, and so he is at 2 third positions right now. Those are the current standings, and the last game of the first batch is still ongoing, so we have to see when this will finish, but probably relatively soon. And I also, the last Sunday, I streamed for the first time. Maybe you actually joined me, maybe you were able to catch this. And I will put a link to my Twitch channel into the description of this YouTube channel. And I don't know yet how often I will stream, but maybe now and then. And if you like it to maybe follow a stream once in a while, then you will know where to find me. Alright, then have a nice time and see you in the next video.